The Cold War is the most important thing we are going to talk about for the second half of the 20th century. The Cold War overshadowed every aspect of world history and was a legacy of the Second World War. But before we pick up in the 20th century, I'm actually going to go back in time for a second. And I'm actually going to start this lecture on the post-World War II era with a quote from 1835. Now, this particular quote comes from a Frenchman, Alexis de Tocqueville, who was touring the United States, and he produced a legendary book, Democracy in America. You might have read some of it in your American history classes or talked about him in a political science class. Tocqueville was writing during a time of great expansion of American power throughout the continent. Keep in mind that just a few years before he published the book, the Congress passed the Indian Removal Act that forcefully removed the Cherokee, Creek, Chickasaw, Seminole, and Choctaw Indians from the southeastern United States and provided a foundation for future removal further west. The United States was not the only country that was expanding its influence across a continent. Tsar Nicholas I of Russia was also undertaking territorial expansion, and it would be during his reign that Russia reached its largest geographical range at almost 8 million square miles. Today, Russia's about 6.6 million square miles. So if you combine the landmass of Russia and India, you'd have almost 8 million square miles. Long story short, Russia was, and is, big. So back to Alexis de Tocqueville. In Democracy in America, at the end of the first volume, Tocqueville made a connection between the United States and Russia. He wrote, quote, "There are, at the present time, two great nations in the world which seem to tend towards the same end, although they started from different points. I allude to the Russians and the Americans. Each of them seems to be marked out by the will of heaven to sway the destinies of half the globe." End quote. So now, fast forward to the end of World War II. Britain and France were destroyed. Smaller nations in Europe were destroyed as well. The Soviet Union, even with wartime losses of about 28 million people, most of them civilians, was the only power in Europe still standing. The Soviet Union, even with the wartime loss of 28 million people, most of them civilians, was the only power in Europe still standing. The United States was also still standing, but worried about the loss of industrial output the wartime emergency had provided. Basically, at the end of World War II, the world stood on a precipice. Now, these two great powers, the United States and the Soviet Union, who had allied against Hitler and the Nazis, became enemies, and they seemed to have the destinies of the world in their hands. This lecture is going to look back at the early years of the Cold War, examine its origins, and how the United States and the Soviet Union acted and reacted during this conflict. One thing about the Cold War, it's a lot of tit for tat. It's almost like a tennis match, or it's really a chess game, each one kind of acting and reacting. Well, first, let's talk about the term Cold War. Our textbook defines the Cold War in an actually pretty simple way. Quote, "The ideological struggle between communism, the Soviet Union, and capitalism, the United States, for world influence." And that comes to us from page 657 of the textbook. The Soviet Union and the United States had been at ideological odds since the Bolshevik Revolution, but that difference hadn't really come to much other than a Red Scare during the First World War in the United States, when the federal government raided offices and jailed people accused of communism and subversive actions against the war effort. During World War II, of course, the United States and the Soviet Union allied against Hitler. President Roosevelt encouraged a policy of cooperation with the Soviet Union to basically put ideological differences aside in the name of stamping out Nazism and fascism. After the death of Roosevelt, however, that cooperation moved increasingly towards conflict. This conflict existed for at least a year before the term Cold War was applied to it. It's called a Cold War because the United States and the Soviet Union never came into direct military conflict. Instead, they battled over the rest of the world, but never directly. Basically, the world became a chess match between these powers. The Cold War, again, overshadowed everything in the second half of the 20th century. A former British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, called the developments in Europe an Iron Curtain. President Truman invited Churchill to speak at the college graduation in Fulton, Missouri at Westminster College. It was a small school in Truman's home state. Truman, by the way, is the last president who did not attend college. So that's kind of interesting. Anyway, in what Churchill called his Sinews of Peace speech, he laid out what he believed Russia was up to. Churchill's overall argument in the speech was that peace was possible with Russia, but the West had to be vigilant that the Soviet Union would not become too powerful. Churchill warned of growing Soviet influence when he said,
"An iron curtain has descended across the continent. Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow."
He also warned,
The communist parties, which were very small in all these eastern states of Europe, have been raised to preeminence and power far beyond their numbers and are seeking everywhere to obtain totalitarian control. Police governments are prevailing in nearly every case, and so far, except in Czechoslovakia, there is no true democracy.
Beyond Soviet expansion in areas outside Central and Eastern Europe, Churchill warned that the Soviets were meddling in the affairs of the defeated Germany when he said,
"An attempt is being made by the Russians in Berlin to build up a quasi-communist party in their zone of occupied Germany by showing special favors to groups of left-wing German leaders. If now the Soviet government tries by separate action to build up a pro-communist Germany in their areas, this will cause new serious difficulties in the American and British zones and will give the defeated Germans the power of putting themselves up to auction between the Soviets and the Western democracies. Whatever conclusions may be drawn from these facts, in fact they are, this is certainly not the liberated Europe we fought to build up, nor is it one which contains the essentials of permanent peace."
Remember how I said during the World War II lecture that Churchill was such an optimist? I know this speech doesn't sound very optimistic so far, but keep in mind, this is a graduation ceremony. It's not sounding very inspirational, if you ask me. But Churchill reminded these future leaders graduating that day,
"Ladies and gentlemen, I repulse the idea that a new war is inevitable, still more that it is imminent. It is because I am sure that our fortune are still in our own hands, and that we hold the power to save the future."
As he saw it,
"There never was a war in history easier to prevent by timely action than the one which has just desolated such great areas of the globe. It could have been prevented, in my belief, without the firing of a single shot, and Germany might be powerful, prosperous, and honored today. But no one would listen. One by one, we were all sucked into the awful whirlpool. Surely, ladies and gentlemen, I put it to you, surely we must not let that happen again."
Winston Churchill gave a name to something that didn't have a name yet. He called it the Iron Curtain. We would call it the Cold War. And I think I want to put a pin on the Cold War for right now. I know we're only about 8.5 minutes in, but I think this is a good stopping point. In the next lecture, we're going to talk about some of the deeper origins of the Cold War and get back to some of those diplomatic conferences during World War II that were really where the Cold War originated from.